From New York, this is Democracy Now!
It is clearly now the will of the Parliamentary Conservative Party that there should be a new leader of that party and therefore a new Prime Minister.
Faced with about 60 resignations from within his own cabinet and party, British Prime Minister Boris Johnson has resigned as leader of the Conservative Party, but will remain as Prime Minister until a successor is picked. Many are calling him to resign as PM immediately. We'll get the latest. Then look at the growing economic crisis in Sri Lanka and across the global south as nations confront soaring energy and food costs. Finally, Left Internationalism in the Heart of Empire. That's the title of an essay in Dissent magazine by Cornell professor Aziz Rana.
The long story of the national security establishment is really one of repeated failures and blunders all the way down to the present. And yet every time there's an international crisis, it's as if the past is wiped away and it's the left that's on the defensive. It's essential to reverse this, and that's going to require not just clear alternatives, but also mobilizing and institution building specifically on left foreign policy.
We'll speak with Professor Rana and anthropologist Daryl Lee, author of The Universal Enemy, Jihad, Empire, and the Challenge of Solidarity. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Boris Johnson has announced his resignation as leader of the United Kingdom's Conservative Party after he lost the support of much of his own cabinet. Johnson spoke earlier today outside his official residence, 10 Downing Street, after some 60 members of parliament quit his government in recent days to protest a series of scandals.
It is clearly now the will of the Parliamentary Conservative Party that there should be a new leader of that party and therefore a new Prime Minister. And I've agreed with Sir Graham Brady, the chairman of our backbench MPs, that the process of choosing that new leader should begin now. And the timetable will be announced next week. And I've today appointed a cabinet to serve, as I will, until a new leader is in place.
Boris Johnson now faces widespread calls for his immediate resignation as Prime Minister, including from prominent members of his own party. After headlines, we'll go to the UK for the latest. In Illinois, a prosecutor investigating Monday's massacre at a 4th of July parade in Highland Park says the suspect has confessed to the mass shooting, which left 7 people dead and more than 24 wounded. 21-year-old Robert Cremo III faces 7 counts of first-degree murder and dozens of other charges that could bring him life in prison without parole. On Wednesday, a police spokesperson said Cremo contemplated carrying out another mass shooting at a July 4th celebration in Madison, Wisconsin, after he fled the scene of the Highland Park shooting.
What investigative leads have thus turned up is that while he was driving and he located this celebration occurring in the Madison area, he contemplated another attack with the firearm he had in his car.
Police in Richmond, Virginia, say they thwarted a massacre at a 4th of July celebration Monday after receiving a call from a tipster who overheard a conversation about plans for a mass shooting at a local amphitheater. Police arrested 2 suspects they say were armed for mass murder.
They seized 2 assault rifles, 1 handgun, and 223 rounds of ammunition.
In Orlando, Florida, at least 12 people were injured in a stampede on July 4th after people mistook fireworks for gunfire and fled, causing a panic. Elsewhere, Philadelphia's mayor says he's worried about the security of crowds and large-scale gatherings after 2 police officers were shot and injured during a 4th of July fireworks show in Philadelphia. This comes as new data from the Marshall Project shows mass shootings have become more common and more deadly in the United States over the past 5 years. In Mississippi, pro-choice activists confronted anti-abortion protesters outside the Jackson Women's Health Organization Wednesday on the clinic's last day of operation. The clinic is at the center of the Supreme Court case that struck down Roe v. Wade and affirmed Mississippi's near-total ban on abortions. Elsewhere, Texas's most high-profile abortion care provider said Wednesday it'll move its operations to New Mexico. Whole Women's Health is closing its Texas clinics after the state Supreme Court allowed a century-old abortion ban to take effect. Meanwhile, Rolling Stone magazine reports a prominent Capitol Hill evangelical leader was caught on a hot mic boasting she prayed with sitting Supreme Court justices. The disclosure by anti-abortion activist Peggy Kneeneighbor suggests a major conflict of interest with the court. Her ministry's umbrella organization, Liberty Counsel, filed an amicus brief in the landmark case Dobbs v. Jackson Women's Health, which overturned 50 years of Supreme Court precedent on abortion rights. In El Salvador, a woman was found guilty of homicide last week and sentenced to 50 years in prison after she lost her fetus in the ninth month of pregnancy. Rights groups say that Leslie Lisbeth Ramirez was just 19 years old when she suffered an obstetric emergency in her home during June of 2020, leading to the end of her pregnancy. This appears to be the harshest sentence ever handed down in El Salvador to a woman accused of abortion, which is a criminal offense. The United Nations warned Wednesday up to 828 million people were affected by hunger last year, or about 10% of humanity. That figure represents an increase from soaring levels of hunger and malnutrition seen in 2020. The UN says food shortages caused by the climate crisis and the war in Ukraine threaten starvation and mass migration on an unprecedented scale. In Ukraine, the mayor of Mykolaiv has ordered residents to evacuate, saying no part of the Black Sea port city remains safe against a Russian assault as fire crews battled huge blazes sparked by the fighting. Elsewhere, Ukraine's second-largest city, Kharkiv, remains under heavy fire from long-range Russian artillery. On Wednesday, Irish Prime Minister Mikhail Martin traveled to Kyiv, where he met Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. Martin said Ireland stands ready to support Ukraine's post-war reconstruction and to help hold Russia accountable.
The use of terror against and the deliberate targeting of civilian populations are war crimes. Those responsible, those carrying out these actions and those directing them will be held fully accountable, and there will be no hiding places.
In response, former Russian President Dmitry Medvedev warned the U.S. and its allies could face nuclear retaliation if they pursue an international tribunal to investigate Russian war crimes committed in Ukraine. Medvedev wrote on social media, quote, "The idea of punishing a country that is one of the largest nuclear potentials is absurd and potentially poses a threat to the existence of humanity." Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov has arrived in Bali, Indonesia, for a meeting of G20 foreign ministers. Lavrov is expected to discuss the war in Ukraine with several top diplomats, though the Biden administration has ruled out any meeting with Secretary of State Tony Blinken. The White House says President Biden and Vice President Harris have both spoken to the wife of WNBA star Brittany Griner, who faces up to 10 years in a Russian prison after she was arrested in Moscow's airport last February on having cannabis oil in her luggage. Biden's and Harris's phone call to Sherelle Griner Wednesday came more than 2 weeks after the State Department botched a plan to have the couple speak by phone on their fourth wedding anniversary. It also came after Brittany Griner appealed directly to Biden for help in a handwritten letter. White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre said securing Griner's release would be a top priority of the president.
I can say that the president did read the letter. I was there when he read the letter. This is something, Brittany Griner being held in Moscow, we believe the Federation is wrongfully detained in Moscow at this time. This is an issue that is a priority for this president.
The Biden administration said Wednesday it'll levy new sanctions against 15 individuals and entities allegedly linked to the illicit sale and shipment of Iranian oil. The Treasury Department cited a 2018 executive order by then-Donald Trump as the basis for the penalties. That's despite President Biden's criticism of Trump's maximum pressure policy against Iran during the 2020 presidential campaign. This comes after days of indirect talks in Qatar between Iranian and U.S. diplomats failed to reach a deal to have the United States rejoin the Iran nuclear deal, the landmark 2015 agreement that President Trump unilaterally withdrew the U.S. from in 2018. Iran's foreign minister said after the failed talks, his nation stands willing to scale back its nuclear program in exchange for sanctions relief.
The American side should guarantee that Iran will fully benefit from a 2015 revived deal. So far, the American side has not been able to give such assurances.
Iran says President Biden could rejoin the Iran nuclear deal at any time via executive order. And former White House counsel Pat Cipollone will testify before the House Select Committee investigating the January 6th attack on the Capitol. Cipollone is set to testify by video link behind closed doors Friday. The committee subpoenaed Cipollone last week after former White House aide Cassidy Hutchinson's testimony indicated he had firsthand knowledge of potential criminal activity in the Trump White House.
Mr. Cipollone said something to the effect of, please make sure we don't go up to the Capitol, Cassidy. Keep in touch with me. We're going to get charged with every crime imaginable if we make that movement happen.
The committee plans to ask Pat Cipollone about Trump's efforts to subvert the election, a scheme to submit fake electoral ballots, Trump's attempts to replace Justice Department leadership, including the attorney general, and attempts to directly interfere with Congress's activities on January 6, 2021. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Democracy Now! Co-host Nermeen Shaikh. Hi, Nermeen.
Across the country and around the world.
Well, British Prime Minister Boris Johnson has announced he's resigning as head of the Conservative Party and will then resign as prime minister once his party elects a successor. He spoke outside 10 Downing Street earlier today.
It is clearly now the will of the Parliamentary Conservative Party that there should be a new leader of that party and therefore a new prime minister. And I've agreed with Sir Graham Brady, the chairman of our backbench MPs, that the process of choosing that new leader should begin now. And the timetable will be announced next week. And I've today appointed a cabinet to serve, as I will, until a new leader is in place.
In recent days, about 60 officials in Boris Johnson's government have resigned. On Wednesday night, a group of cabinet members went to 10 Downing Street to urge Johnson to step down. Despite the calls for him to resign as prime minister immediately, Johnson has begun reassembling a new cabinet to fill the posts left vacant by this flood of resignations. Boris Johnson, who is a leading supporter of Brexit, has served as prime minister since 2019 and has been embroiled in numerous scandals. This week's resignations came as Johnson faced criticism for promoting a member of his Conservative Party who was accused of groping two men. On Tuesday, a Downing Street spokesperson admitted Johnson had been briefed in 2019 about the sexual abuse allegations, but claimed he had forgotten about the complaints. One of the first two cabinet ministers to resign was Health Secretary Sajid Javid. He spoke yesterday about why he stepped down.
I continued to give the benefit of the doubt. And now this week again, we have reason to question the truth and integrity of what we've all been told. And at some point, we have to conclude that enough is enough. Yeah. I believe that point is now. Yeah. I have concluded that the problem starts at the top, and I believe that is not going to change. And that means that it is for those of us in a position who have responsibility to make that change.
We're joined now by Priya Gopal, English professor at University of Cambridge, author of Insurgent Empire, Anti-Colonial Resistance and British Dissent. Professor Gopal, it's great to have you back. We just heard the speech of the prime minister before we went to air, especially for a non-British audience. If you can explain what has led to this moment and what does it mean that while he resigned as head of the Conservative Party, he's still hanging on to the prime ministership, though so many within his own party are demanding he resign immediately.
Yes. As I suggested on your show last time, and last time was not a very long time ago, this was more or less inevitable. He had just survived at that time a no confidence vote. And I suggested then that he was very damaged And what we see now is that the inevitable has happened. It's high farce at one level, Johnson clinging to power, even now wanting to stay on till October and somehow, you know, stay in Downing Street. It's farcical at that level, but it's combined, I think, with an ongoing tragedy for ordinary people in Britain. Johnson's last few months have been extraordinarily chaotic and complicated, but those actually reflect the wider, you know, the wider 3 years or so in power, which have, I think, been disastrous for ordinary people. He has, of course, attempted in a Trump-like way till very late last night to say that he would not leave, that they would have to wash their hands in blood if they wanted him to leave. And there are people who expect him to continue to produce drama. But what has led to this moment is that a very damaged Boris Johnson was not able to survive more allegations about, you know, things that he knew and had not done anything about. And it just became clear that, you know, this was one lie too far, that people, even in his own party, who had actually been complicit in keeping him in power, who knew he was prone to lying, who knew about his incompetence, who knew about the chaos, they were complicit until this week they decided that it was not in their interests to continue to be complicit.
And Priya, what do you think is likely to happen now? Who is the front runner, if there is one, to replace him? I just heard on the BBC this morning that one person who's considering running, though his prospects appear dim, is Steve Baker, Conservative MP. Who are the others?
Yes, I mean, it's not entirely clear who will be in the running. Suella Braverman, the Attorney General, has also said that she intends to throw her a hat in the ring. These are, as you just suggested, outliers. We don't know who amongst the real prospects will be in the running. I think one can assume that some of the names that have been bandied around in recent days, Liz Truss, the foreign secretary, might be in the running. Michael Gove, who actually Johnson in a very farcical moment fired last night, he might be in the running. Possibly Nadeem Zahawi, who is currently the chancellor. He's just been appointed chancellor. So there are various names being bandied around. We don't know who the front runner will be, but I think one thing we do know, that whoever takes over now, on the one hand, will have to come across as more stable and more capable than Johnson, but on the other hand, is actually likely to be a very serious Brexiteering ideologue and a conservative ideologue. Johnson is an opportunist. He is somebody who really thinks about his own interests first and takes whatever position is convenient in the short term. Whoever replaces him, there is a very good chance of there being a Brexiteering ideologue with very hard right views about policy, about the direction of government. And this does not look good in the immediate and medium term for the British people.
What about in the event that a general election is called? Do you see any likelihood of a Labour government, a more progressive government coming to power in the wake of the obvious disasters of Boris Johnson's administration?
I don't think that those are by any means clear-cut. It is not clear to me and to others I know that if there were to be a general election now, Labour would win. In fact, we are in a situation where Labour has yet to provide serious, definite and a kind of clear option for people to vote for. In fact, all we've had so far is Keir Starmer, the current Labour leader, insisting that he would continue to keep Brexit in place, that he would, in fact, in some sense, keep a hard Brexit in place. We don't know what kinds of alternatives the Labour Party proposes in terms of the huge challenges in front of Britain right now: labor shortages, inflation, inequality, widespread hunger, many institutions in disarray, high inflation. These are all problems that are in the immediate, and we don't, as of now, have a clear plan from Labour as to exactly what they will be setting out in their stall to address this. So I would by no means be optimistic that if there were a general election, that the Tories would lose. I mean, they will probably lose the very high margin that they had. But if they're able to convince people that, you know, the problem was Johnson and that they can now provide an alternative without Johnson, then they may well come back. And of course, the truth is that the problem was not just Johnson, that the Tory project is a very destructive project, that it has been incredibly harmful for Britain to go through a hard Brexit, and there are problems yet to come. And it is by no means clear that whoever comes back or comes after Johnson leaves as the Tory prime minister is going to be providing anything more cheerful or progressive for Britain.
I want to go back to Boris Johnson's speech just before we broadcast.
The reason I have fought so hard in the last few days to continue to deliver that mandate in person was not just because I wanted to do so, but because I felt it was my job, my duty, my obligation to you to continue to do what we promised in 2019. And of course, I'm immensely proud of the achievements of this government, from getting Brexit done to settling our relations with the continent for over half a century, reclaiming the power for this country to make its own laws in Parliament, getting us all through the pandemic, delivering the fastest vaccine rollout in Europe, the fastest exit from lockdown, and in the last few months, leading the West in standing up to Putin's aggression in Ukraine.
So if you can assess, as we wrap up, Professor Gopal, what he has done from Brexit to Ukraine, and also what this means for Ireland.
Well, I mean, he's certainly been trying to Ukraine wash himself in the last few months, the last few chaotic months, having photo ops with President Zelensky, suggesting that he is leading the West in its response, which is clearly not exactly the case. It is probably true that the vaccine rollout was, in fact, very fast and very well done. But everything else raises a lot of questions. Is Brexit done? Relations with the continent, with Europe, are at a historic low, and Britain is in the position of breaking treaties. The Northern Ireland Protocol is in trouble, and Europe has lost faith in Britain's ability to hold up its end of the bargain. What does it mean to get Brexit done? A hard Brexit, we are only just starting to see the consequences, and the economic consequences currently have been disastrous. And we are living in a situation with labor shortages, food shortages, as well as a high cost of living. So if you got Brexit done, then the question is, what have the consequences of that Brexit been so far for the ordinary people of Britain?
Professor Gopal, I want to thank you for being with us. English professor at University of Cambridge, author of Insurgent Empire. The subtitle of that is Anti-Colonial Resistance and British Dissent. Next up, we look at the growing economic crisis in Sri Lanka and across the global south as nations confront soaring energy and food costs. Stay with us.
To let me know, should I stay or should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know, should I stay or should I go? It's always tease, tease, tease. You're happy when I'm on my knees. One day is fine, the next is black. So if you want me off your back, well, come on and let me know. Should I stay or should I go? Should I stay or should I go now? Should I stay or should I go now?
Should I Stay or Should I Go? By the British group The Clash. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Shaikh. As we go now to the island nation of Sri Lanka, where protests are escalating amidst a growing economic crisis and gas shortage faced by some 22 million people, many forced to wait for days and nights in long lines for fuel.
When the petrol problem came up, I tried to use WhatsApp group chats to check where petrol was available, but that was not practical. First, it was 2 or 3 hours in a petrol queue, then it was 4, 6, and up to 8 hours. About 3 weeks ago, I was in a petrol queue for 3 days.
Police fired tear gas and water cannons at hundreds of demonstrators near Sri Lanka's parliament Wednesday as they called for the president, Gotabaya Rajapaksa, to step down. Sri Lanka's government's forced the country's schools to stay closed for another week because there's not enough gas for students and teachers to travel to school. Authorities also announced plans to cut electricity by up to 3 hours a day because Sri Lanka doesn't have enough fuel. Sri Lanka's president said Wednesday on Twitter he'd reached out to Russian President Vladimir Putin and, quote, requested an offer of credit support to import fuel. Meanwhile, Sri Lanka's also facing a dire shortage of food and medicine, and doctors are saying the country's entire health system could collapse. On Tuesday, Sri Lanka announced it'll stop printing money, as inflation is expected to reach a record 60% this year. For more, we go to the Sri Lankan capital of Colombo to speak with Ahilan Kartagamar. He is political economist and senior lecturer at the University of Jaffna in Jaffna. His recent op-ed for the Daily Mirror headlined, "When they can't govern, they must go home." Welcome back to Democracy Now! Can you start off by explaining the extent of the issue and the significance of Sri Lanka saying it's turning to Russia for support to get fuel?
Thank you for having me, Amy. The situation from week to week has been deteriorating. Over the last 6 months, Sri Lanka was going into a major downturn. But in the last 3 months, and we've had a new prime minister in power since May 11th, and even in those few months, as Sri Lanka has been preparing to go for an IMF agreement, an IMF team was in Sri Lanka for 2 weeks. The last 2 weeks, an assistant secretary of the U.S. Treasury, an assistant secretary of the state from the United States were here visiting. Very high officials from India were here, but no deal was made. And now Sri Lanka is in a very dire situation. Even the World Bank and the IMF expect Sri Lanka's economy to shrink by anywhere from 6 to 8%. That is negative GDP growth of, in my view, as probably over 10% this year. So it's, you know, farmers have stopped cultivating, fishermen can't go to the sea because they don't have kerosene oil, and our entire informal sector, 60% of our economy is the informal sector, has come grinding to a halt because of fuel shortages. And the people are blaming President Gotabaya Rajapaksa and Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe for the continued economic crisis that they are facing. And it's in that context, there is likely to be a very powerful wave of protests starting this Saturday. We saw that 2 months ago when the president's brother, Mahinda Rajapaksa, resigned as prime minister. Now, day after tomorrow, there's going to be very massive protests calling for the resignation of the president and prime minister. And it's in the context of this wave that the president is also desperately asking various actors, including President Putin of Russia, to provide oil to try to pacify the masses here in Sri Lanka.
Ahilan, could you talk about how the government has so far responded to these protests? And also a piece that you wrote earlier this week, headlined, "When they can't govern, they must go home," in which you point out that the ideology of our ruling class, namely Sri Lanka's ruling class, for decades has been one of solving all our problems, from food security to people's livelihoods, by importing. Now, what does that have to do with the scale of the crisis right now, the fact that Sri Lanka was so heavily dependent on imports?
Sri Lanka was the first country in South Asia to liberalize its economy way back in 1977. This was even well before the election of President Reagan and Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. Sri Lanka was put on the neoliberal path with structural adjustment policies of the IMF and the World Bank. And some of the things that we did, including in agriculture, which meant that we became even dependent for food in terms of imports. A lot of produce that could have been produced here, whether it's milk foods, whether it's vegetables, all of these started to be imported. And we started an economy that was very much even more dependent on the external sector. And that was then further accelerated after the long civil war in Sri Lanka, which ended in 2009, with excessive borrowings in the international financial markets, what are called sovereign bonds. So this dependency and this idea that we can import our way out through debt has continued to this day. I would argue even now, over the last 4 months, the government thinks that the solution to all our problems is to go for an IMF solution, IMF agreement. And as if the IMF can come into Sri Lanka and completely restructure the economy and make everything fine. In other words, there is no discussion on the part of the government on how we as Sri Lankans are going to come out of this crisis, how we are going to address the great inequalities in this country. But instead, they've been implementing austerity measures over the last 3-4 months, which have made the burden on the people that much more harsher. So at the core of this is the class question in terms of who has benefited from these imports and this inflow of global finance, and who is asked to pay for it now, as the cost of living, if you take the price of bread, it has tripled over the last 6 months. But the incomes and livelihoods of working people have declined or are increasingly disrupted.
And in that
context, as people go out on the streets and they start protesting, the police has become increasingly repressive. They are targeting protesters and arresting them. Students have been in the lead of protests, particularly university students. They've been tear gassed. And it's to be seen what would happen on Saturday when another big wave of protests are to be launched in Sri Lanka, throughout the country, and particularly in Colombo, pressuring the president and prime minister to resign, what the military and the police would do in that context. The demand now is for both of them to resign and for an interim government to be formed to be able to stabilize the country economically and politically, and also to bring about a people's council with representatives of the people, of the protesters, of professional organizations, to be able to stabilize the country until we can have elections and move forward.
Ahilan Kardagama, I want to thank you for being with us, political economist, senior lecturer at University of Jaffna, usually in Jaffna, but right now in Colombo. We'll link to your piece in the Daily Mirror, "When They Can't Govern, They Must Go Home." As we turn to put this in a broader context in the global south, amidst the protests in Sri Lanka, there have also been widespread demonstrations in Ghana, in Peru, in Ecuador, and other countries over high gas prices. For more on the impact of these rising fuel prices on countries in the global south, where the impacts have been especially severe amidst the war in Ukraine and the COVID-19 pandemic, we're joined by Antoine Haaf. He is the former chief oil analyst at the International Energy Agency, an adjunct senior research scholar at the Center on Global Energy Policy at Columbia University. Antoine Haaf, welcome to Democracy Now!
Thank you.
So, if you can talk about Sri Lanka, the example of Sri Lanka, and how it compares to what's happening in the rest of the global south.
Yeah, well, Sri Lanka has its own problems linked to the nature of its economy and the shortfall in tourism revenue they had to face with COVID and so on. but they're also part of a broader situation, which is the increase in energy prices over the last few months, which has perhaps accelerated since the invasion of Ukraine. Sri Lanka is entirely dependent on its oil supply, on imports, as are other countries in South Asia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, to various degrees. And it now has to, it has less money to pay for high cost, high priced energy. So hence a shortage. This is not a unique situation. Again, it's we see pressures in Pakistan. We see pressures in all the countries you've mentioned, having to fork out a lot more for their energy supplies. But it's particularly acute in Sri Lanka, partly because they're about 100% dependent on oil imports, and also because of their own underlying issues.
And Antoine, just to give a sense of the scale of the increase of these prices, international coal prices have reportedly risen five times since last year, while natural gas prices have gone up 10 times more than what they were last year. So if you could respond to, well, explain what you think might reduce the prices. There are those who say that it's only a global recession that would bring the prices of fuel down. And if that is not to occur, if fuel prices are not to go down, how are these countries who are so dependent on fuel and gas imports supposed to cope?
Yeah, well, it's tough. So what's very unique about this situation is that it's a complete energy crisis, as opposed to earlier major oil crisis in the 1970s, the first oil shock of 1973, the Iranian Revolution of 1979, more recent events. We're more focused on the oil market. Today, we have concerns about oil, about gas, about coal, as you said. It's really across the board, but with differences depending on which fuel you look at. So in oil, there's a tightness that's been building over the last few years because we had a shortfall of investment in capacity that has lasted, started around the first price collapse of 2014. Then we had a second price collapse at the time of the first wave of COVID that has really discouraged investment. The transition to a cleaner energy mix, the energy transition, also has discouraged a lot of investment in the upstream. So we have not had the kind of reinvestment in production capacity that you would normally have. And at the same time, demand was depressed because of COVID, but now it's coming back with a vengeance. So there's an imbalance, or there was an imbalance, and we had a very steady tightening of the supply-demand balances over the last year and a big drop in global inventories throughout 2021. Ironically, since the start of the invasion of Ukraine, inventories on the global stage have started to bounce back, and they're now significantly higher than they were before February 24th, partly because the sanctions against Russia are not really reining in Russian supplies. Supplies are not going where they used to go, Europe in particular, the US to some extent. They're going more to Asia, but they haven't been really reduced dramatically, at least not yet. But they're going elsewhere. More recently, we're seeing a little bit of a drop in inventories again, because one factor that helped rebuild inventories over the last few months was also COVID in China and the lockdown of Shanghai and other cities. As Shanghai comes out of confinement, demand rebounds a bit there. So we have a structural crisis, structural and cyclical crisis in the oil market, which is not going to be resolved anytime soon. It's not going to get worse. There's many forecasts out there saying we're going to hit $200, $300 a barrel of oil. That's not going to happen. We're not going to go so high. But we'll probably stay for an extended period between $90 and $130 a barrel, which is historically high. Now, if you turn to natural gas, it's a completely different story, because gas is not at all as flexible as oil. So when gas exports from Russia to Europe go down, they cannot easily be redirected elsewhere, and Europe cannot easily replace those imports with other supplies. So there's a dramatic tightening of gas supplies, which is going to get a lot worse over the next few months, and for which there's no quick solution. But it's not affecting Sri Lanka per se directly, because Sri Lanka is not an importer of natural gas, of LNG. It was planning to. It had announced recently plans to build LNG capacity to shift some of its electricity generation from coal to gas to be cleaner. Now, those plans are called into question. It looks unlikely that this is going to happen over the next the foreseeable future. It might be on hold. But it's not really hitting the Sri Lankan economy directly.
And Antoine, finally, if you could explain, you've just said that there is a distinction between natural gas and oil. Now, the price of oil, irrespective of where one imports from, whether it's Russia, the U.S., or Saudi Arabia, the price of oil is set on the global market. So could you explain how that impacts the ways in which countries can import oil, even as prices vary, and also whether that's true of natural gas?
Yeah, sure. Oil is a global commodity. Oil is fungible. It's easy to transport. That's why it's been so successful as a fuel. That's one of the reasons. So oil gets traded internationally, and all countries import and export oil, almost all of them. So it's really a global market with the price that's set internationally on a planet-wide market. Gas is a bit different. It's much more difficult to transport. Historically, it was transported only by pipeline. Over the last decade, we've seen a very sharp increase in the share of liquefied natural gas in the gas market. Gas that's liquefied at very low temperature and then transported in liquid form on ships, which is much more flexible, and then regasified in the consumer countries at the arrival point. But gas is still a much more fragmented market, more difficult to transport, and therefore we see more differentiated markets, an Asian market, a European market, a US-American market, with different prices. The prices have tended to converge as the share of LNG has increased, but still is differentiated. Another factor in oil, by the way, is the tightness in refining capacity. Many refineries have closed down in the last few years, and that tendency has accelerated with COVID. So we now have a world that's short of refining capacity, except for China, which has a lot of refining capacity available, is sitting on large inventories of crude, but at the moment is not really choosing to help the international market and export the products that it is not consuming at home.
Well, Anton Haaf, we want to thank you for being with us, former chief oil analyst at International Energy Agency, now with the Center on Global Energy Policy at Columbia University, speaking to us from Paris, France. Next up, we go to Aziz Rana, Cornell University professor, wrote a major piece in Dissent magazine called Left Internationalism in the Heart of Empire. We'll speak with Aziz Rana and with Dara Lee, who responds. Stay with us. போராடு போராடு இளங்க இனி ஊனாடும் வீடும் விளங்க போராடு போராடு இளங்க இனி ஊனாடும் வீடும் விளங்க இனவாதம் மதவாதம் ஜெயிக்காது இனவாதம் மதவாதம் ஜெயிக்காது அதெல்லாம் சர்வாதிகாரிக்கு உரைக்காது அப்ப உரைக்கணும்னா என்ன செய்யணும் நாம ஒன்னு சேர்ந்து சண்டை செய்யணும் அப்ப உரைக்கணும்னா என்ன செய்யணும் நாம ஒன்னு சேர்ந்து சண்டை செய்யணும் போராடு Silankar by Erve and the Ambassa Band for the Sri Lankan protesters. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Shaikh. We end today's show looking at left internationalism in the heart of empire. That's the title of an essay in Dissent magazine by Aziz Rana, law professor at Cornell University, author of the book The Two Faces of American Freedom. Rana writes, quote, "At present, the possible futures that lay before us appear strikingly dystopian. Either we languish in an old, broken Pax Americana, or we slide into a new multipolar order dictated by competing capitalist authoritarianisms. Without a strong and coherent left alternative, finding a global pathway better than these options will only be that much harder," he says. Dissent has also published responses to Professor Rana's essay by a number of scholars, including the anthropologist Dara Lee, professor at the University of Chicago, author of The Universal Enemy, Jihad, Empire, and the Challenge of Solidarity. Dara Lee and Aziz Rana join us now. Let's begin with Professor Aziz Rana. Why don't you lay out your argument in this major piece that you have written for Dissent that has gotten so much response?
Well, first, thanks so much for having me on the show. It's great to be here. So the argument that I make is that if you just think of the long history of the national security establishment's policies throughout the entire post-Cold War period, it's one of repeated failure. So these are terrible elective wars of choice in the Middle East, along with destructive neoliberal policies that have really promoted austerity and mass economic immiseration across large segments of the world, including coming back home in the U.S. And yet every time there's a new international crisis, it's as if that past is just wiped clean, and it's instead left critics of the national security establishment that find themselves on the defensive. And so I try to kind of work through why that's the case. And the argument that I make is it has to do with certain tendencies in the way in which left voices articulate opposition to the national security framework. And it also has to do with the fact that the left really needs clear alternatives to the hardest questions, and that all of that requires thinking about foreign policy in a way that's different than we traditionally do. We tend to think of the domestic realm as a site for mobilization, for movement building, for power building. But we think of foreign policy as about expertise. And that actually has to be broken. The strongest periods of sustained left international foreign policy were times in which you had really powerful transnational movements tied to labor and then tied to anti-colonial movements that linked together unions at home and abroad, as well as anti-racist forces in the U.S. and anti-colonial forces overseas, and that we need something similar. We need to have strong transnational institutions built around mobilization that create and stitch together a common vision of what the future will hold. And that means pressing for policies that you might not oftentimes think of as about power building. Take, for instance, opposition or containment of international corporate property rights, strengthening global labor rights. These are good for workers, but they're also a way of reviving perhaps the classic 20th century institution of the transnational left, which was global labor. That there needs to be infrastructures and homes to house conversations across borders about how to build an alternative world.
So, Dara Lee, could we get your response? You are one of the respondents to Aziz in this special issue of a Dissent on Foreign Policy, which is now out. One of the points that you make in your response is talking about the American left response to the crisis that ensued following the popular uprising in Syria in 2011. You write, quote, "While online leftists loudly tore each other to shreds, Washington and Damascus, backed by Moscow, quietly arrived at a modus vivendi whereby each side could bomb its enemies while they worked together to ensure their jets did not collide." How do you interpret that response in 2011 and for many years after that, to what's happening now with respect to the left response to the Russian invasion of Ukraine?
Good morning. Thanks for having me on. I think the point that I was trying to make there sort of is the unfortunate mirror of the dilemma that Aziz lays out in his article, which is that in a series of crises since the end of the Cold War, where humanitarian intervention, or better yet, humanitarian invasion, has been on the cards, the people who identify with the left in the West, in the United States, are constantly, again and again, kind of being pushed into a corner or boxed in. And I think it's important to recognize that that's a structural dilemma, right? Like in any situation where there is talk about humanitarian invasion, we are talking about a situation of some kind of great power competition, right? Because if it was a situation where the West clearly had hegemony, we wouldn't be talking about humanitarian invasion in the first place. And if it's a situation where a non-Western great power is calling the shots, then the West doesn't have a low-cost military option to begin with. So in places like ex-Yugoslavia in the 90s and then Libya and Syria later on, these are situations where, yes, the United States is engaged in acts of imperialism and violence, but it's also not the only significant actor on the ground. And that is the persistent structural dilemma that the left has really struggled with and just not had a clear answer to over the past few decades.
The moment, in the case of Ukraine, at least initially, there was one clear aggressor, though now the equation has completely changed with the influx of massive amounts of military aid and defensive military equipment. So can you speak specifically about that and how that complicates or should complicate or may complicate the U.S. Left's response?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's just a more intense version of the dilemma. Clearly, you have a war of aggression by Russia, but of course, U.S. and NATO imperialism is another very important factor in the overall discussion. And what's been the thing that has really struck me about this conversation with folks on the left in the West is that it is largely kind of rested on a denunciation of hypocrisy and double standards by the West, right? Talking about why the U.S. is paying attention to Ukraine and not other places, or decrying the sort of racist treatment and abuse of refugees of African origin in the area. And I think calling out hypocrisy and double standards is absolutely necessary and just and correct, but it needs to be the start of the conversation. And too often it's where the analysis sort of ends. And I think that is actually a symptom of the kind of disempowerment that Aziz is talking about, where the left in the West has a clearer sense of what it stands against and not as clear a sense of what it stands for in these types of situations.
Professor Aziz Rana, if you could respond to Professor Lee and also talk about what a genuine left global international would look like. You talk about the strengthening of labor rights around the world and formulating a critique of undoing neoliberalism central to forming such a global movement.
Yeah, so, first I agree pretty entirely with what Daryl was just saying, which is that, and Ukraine in a way is a microcosm of this problem, which is that there are kind of two tendencies that you see in the U.S. So you have one tendency, which in the face of a kind of clear agenda from the U.S. national security state that puts together a set of policies that are really a conveyor belt of policies that snap into place almost regardless of what the crisis is. We're seeing this again in Ukraine, that combine aggressive sanctions, militarized confrontation. One position is to just accede to what the state is doing. And so you have, for instance, the elected wing of the social democratic elements of the Democratic Party, more or less just accepting whatever it is that the Biden administration is pursuing, up to and including defense spending in the context of Ukraine that exceeds or is equal to the entire State Department's budget. So accepting an old separation between domestic and foreign, where foreign is not what you organize around, except if there are actual American boots on the ground. And so that's one position that I think is a kind of silence that's a huge problem. But then the other position is to avoid recognizing the incipient forms of really capitalist authoritarianism that we're seeing in the breakdown of American unipolarity and the rise of a multipolar order. And so refusing to call out the kinds of imperialism and authoritarianism that doesn't necessarily come out of the U.S. And so it's really important in this moment to have a politics that, as a colleague, Bassam Haddad, has noted, articulates a principle of anti-imperialism and anti-authoritarianism together. Now, what I would say in the context of Ukraine is that this is an act of imperial aggression that is a violation of any anti-colonial principle of self-determination. And so it requires strong support for defensive military assistance of a country that's facing an imperial invader. But the issue with the American approach is that that's been combined with a geostrategic effort to really weaken a regional adversary, and so has been wrapped up in this aggressive sanctions and militarized confrontation policy that has really deleterious effects for the future of Europe, in my view, as well as for humanitarian conditions, both in Ukraine, but then also around the world. And so rather than accepting an either-or framework, where you can either sign up to everything that the U.S. does or just support non-intervention, I think it requires a disaggregated approach that emphasizes the importance, yes, of genuinely defensive military assistance, but that's tied to a focus on de-escalation, diplomatic negotiation that puts front and center local concerns, but also humanitarian suffering, and that is tied to a genuinely solidaristic global approach that looks at the humanitarian effects worldwide. We just heard about what was happening in Sri Lanka, and it's, I think, a significant flaw of the American conversation that the fact that, as the UN Secretary General says, 1.7 billion people around the world, as a function of both the war and the sanctions approach, find themselves facing precarity in the context of global food, energy, and financial crises, that hasn't been part of the response. There's clearly money. If there's money for weapons to flood Europe, there's certainly money to address some of these harms that are taking place far away from Ukraine and Russia. And that should be part of the conversation that we have, but that requires resisting the either-or framework that's being presented. And as far as like a global agenda, you know, there are lots of elements of what I think would be an important left foreign policy, confronting climate change, dealing with issues of economic redistribution, creating something like a genuinely different approach and a redistributed approach to the global commons. But I think the first and most important thing is creating the transnational infrastructure for left forces across the world to be able to speak to each other. Whenever there's a new crisis, and this is the last point that I'll make, whenever there's a new crisis, it's very easy for, you know, Biden to talk to Boris Johnson or to Zelensky, because there are these networks across nation state organizations and national security frameworks. But the left has basically been contained over the last 50 years in the context of conservative retrenchment within its borders. And the folks that are talking about foreign policy, frankly, in the U.S. are people like me, which are kind of footloose academics that have no real connection to movements or to global institutions. And that actually has to be reversed, that you have to be able to build frameworks in which you have left forces across the world in conversation to build up alternative approaches. And that, to me, puts a premium on the kinds of reforms that we might think of as non-reformist reforms that strengthen the power of transnational left institutions. So this has to do with the position of the global labor movement, but it also has to do with the position of immigrants and migrant rights. So a strong commitment to decriminalizing the border, which is a way of strengthening working class actors both within the U.S. and across the border. And it also has to do with significant changes to the nature of our security budget, cutbacks on the security budget, which then mobilize domestic forces around economic needs and show how economic needs, like pressing for a public commitment to health, education, housing, et cetera, are directly tied to the actions of the national security state and have implications for how American corporations and military elites operate abroad.
And very quickly, Daryl, we just have 30 seconds, but we're going to continue this conversation after the broadcast. You speak about the difficulty of what Aziz is saying, because, of course, the left position is determined in part by where you are in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think solidarity is extremely important. I think it's also true that solidarity is extremely messy. And for people on the left in the West, showing solidarity with people in other parts of the world can be more challenging or less challenging, especially if we're talking about people whose primary oppressors, whose primary concern are geostrategic rivals of the United States. But I think that's all the more reason why it's important to have robust institutions to allow these conversations to happen in the way that Aziz was pointing out.
And we're going to do part two and post it online at democracynow.org. Dara Lee of University of Chicago, as well as Aziz Rana of Cornell. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Shaikh. Stay safe.